amazing stories and cases and examples, and let's open the discussion. Yes, please.
Thank you for your presentation. I just want you to clarify for me, and what, maybe I misunderstood you. From my memory, I have a conversation with someone from Rwanda. The dehumanization process took place over years, over decades, of one group of the Hutus against the Tutsis. And so actually within, when the genocide did occur, there were in-laws and spouses who actually did kill their spouses who were of a different ethnic group because the belief that they were not human, because the process took place, the dehumanization process took place for over decades. Can you speak to that?
When you look at Rwanda in general, the genocide one, to me what I've read is there is no Tutsi couple that killed a Hutu spouse. What happened was, if you married the group of the Tutsis or the group of the Hutus would come and kill you with your spouse because you had married maybe a Tutsi, when you're not supposed to marry a Tutsi. So they had that bigger argument, but the couples killing themselves because they think they're not human?
It was an in-law, like a brother-in-law who killed his brother's wife. It was that kind of a scenario. But it was within the family, that was my opinion. But that was one person.
Maybe that was one person. And for example, like they even say that they butchered themselves based on religious perspective. If you're a Hutu but you're a Muslim, they would come and kill you. If you're a Tutsi but you're a Christian or you're a Muslim, so the killing was not only, but at least on a bigger side, you realize that those who survived were those who were intermarried. If you had married a Tutsi and a Hutu would hide you, or if you had married a Hutu, a Tutsi would hide, things like that. It happened on a larger scale.
I have a question. I know that there is some forbidden rule about marriage between some religions. Muslims women cannot marry to other religious men. How your people solve this issue? They change their religion or they break the rules?
In the earlier times, in African societies, they looked at culture above religion. So they never considered much of the religion. That's why you find a Muslim man marrying a Catholic woman and they're staying together, or a Catholic man, or a Catholic lady, or a Muslim lady getting married to a Catholic man. However, still when it comes to the religious leaders, for them they would condemn it, they would feel like, no, it's not proper, it's not okay. If you are a Muslim woman, you're not supposed to get married to a non-Muslim. Or you're a Muslim man, you're not supposed to marry a non-Muslim man. However, or even in the churches, they would say, no, if you bring a Muslim man, we cannot tie the knot. We cannot legally take you as man and wife. You will do it outside, but we shall not, unless you both have read the same religion. But to the African culture, they looked more at our culture, the cultural setup, not the religion. They never considered religion as being important. Because when you look at African culture, this religion was brought by the white man to civilize us, and that's what they say. But we already civilized, because civilization began in Africa. We already have our cultures, we already had our religions, we believed in our different gods. So this thing of Islam and Arabic, Christianity and Jesus and the like and Muhammad came only to destabilize us again. That's why I'm saying if we bring it again, not looking at the religious part of it, not looking, but we look at the cultures, we look at our ethical background, and we marry off. It would be okay. Because I believe that would be the a solution to Palestine and Israel, where the Muslims feel like you can't get married here. Though she told me that there are some who have married, but they are not staying there. Because it might also be a problem if you stay around and you have married a Palestinian and you take this Palestinian to Israel, and it might not make sense.
But don't you think the intermarriage will create more problems? For example, the countries with the more religious or strong religious beliefs, only two people will be in the borders in the rest. The families and the pastor and the mullahs and the neighbors, they will be in a conflict, in a war. It is not only in the religious level, but also the political level. For example, man or woman married from India and Pakistan, they will not get a visa to cross the borders. It will create more conflict. And for example, as Pakistanis, on our passport, we are not allowed to visit Israel. So it will create more problem if I came in West and then if I would marry some girl from Israel, I will be not able to go back to Pakistan. So it is only a conflict between two people, but rest will be, it will create a conflict between more people. So I look at this way.
That's, maybe we can also make research on that and study it more, but that's what I'm saying. If in Africa, to a larger extent, it has worked, we should put the political aspect aside and follow the cultural aspect. Because these people are looking mostly about the political aspect. They are politically generated ideas. But if we would look at the, we don't follow the political aspect, whereby an Indian is not supposed to marry a Pakistani, I think it would work. We just need to study it more and look at it and see how.
If I take an example in my country, that's Pakistan. Most of the marriages, religious marriages, most of couples, lady or man, they were killed. Sooner or later, they are found in doubt, but they always live in danger. They don't have a space to work, they always live in danger places. It creates more problems. And most, I think more than 50%, more or sooner or later they're killed. This is a problem in a country like
Pakistan.
Thank you. I'm listening, and what comes up for me is this question of love. How do we define love? Is love a romantic love? Is love, you know, the parents saying that you have to marry this person because you know who the family is? You know, it kind of gets back to the aesthetic of, like, how are we going to define love as a human race? Because they are arranged marriages, yes. So sometimes we're married because the parents, the family say, you know, you should marry this person. So we really are like getting to the ontological aspect of who we are as human beings. You know, love has to be at the bottom of it. Only by us having the broadest definition of love can we actually get past all of these restrictions that we have told ourselves, you're this, I'm that, and you're the other. So I just say this love more.
It is not only the inter-religious marriage, but even in a country like Pakistan or the Muslim countries, the difference is the marriage is with the consent of the family or the parents and without the consent of the family. That makes also a difference. It is also problematic. And then inter-religion or inter-ethnic, it comes later. Even the marriages without the consent of the parents create a lot of problems.
I have a both of what you two were just saying actually was kind of what my question is also about, kind of bringing together those. So I know there's a few different kind of paradigms or ways to look at marriage, and I know that they kind of differ where you go in the world. So I think it's fair to say in the US, maybe North America generally have a pretty individualistic, like I as an individual fall in love, you know, I want to marry this person, I make this personal choice, you know. And maybe on another angle, there's a little bit more broader cultural
perhaps more like way to look at it, like, you know, this is not just me, it affects my family, I want their approval or their consent, as you said, or, you know, what's good for society, what's good for the larger sphere. So I guess I'm wondering, and this is a very tough question, so I don't expect you to solve it here now, but I'm just curious, if you buy into the argument, okay, like this would be good for society if I can marry outside my sort of sphere, and maybe that could bridge and create peace, kind of how to balance that, you know, between your individual desires or priorities, balancing that with a larger family consideration, you know, your family and the family of your spouse, as well as you're making kind of a sociological argument, this would be good for society to bridge a lot of gaps. So I'm just curious if you have thoughts on that.
But the people who said that culture should be kept pure and so there must not be a mixture. So pure culture should be made available. There are a certain group of people who want to save the cultures. So, you know, that is it also. To keep our culture, we have to keep the cultural traditions also. It is also problematic. I'm not in this favor, but I'm saying what other people are saying. I'm maybe personally, I'm more open-minded. But if the culture has to be pure culture, it has to follow the cultural or traditional values. And marriage is one of the things which you take culture along with, even in the religion or in the studies, the parents, they should teach their children about the laws from the God according to the religion. Because religion also gives to generation the purity. So it will also be problematic for the teachings and the culture. Thank you.
Thank you.
You
want to if you allow me, I want to react to the question asked by my colleague from Iran about the question of intermarriages. I think that, and I would like to underline what you said, there is a difference, a big difference, between religious issues and cultural issues. Although some would argue, and I have nothing to say against that, that religion is an integral part of a culture. Okay? Now, concerning intermarriages, it's not, I would hate to give you the impression that I'm blowing up my own trumpet, but some Moroccan man married a Christian Muslim man, and married a Christian woman, and vice versa. And it suits me. I'm happy to inform you that the marriage ceremonies take place in mosques and churches, and we attended these ceremony in Morocco and in France. In addition to that, verses from the Quran are read inside the church, and verses from the Bible are read inside mosque, because nothing in religion forbids that, okay? Absolutely nothing. This question of hijab, a question of what is the meaning of hijab? It has various, if you consult a dictionary, Sanabil, and Arabic, I mean dictionaries, you have several meanings of hijab, okay? When the sun sets, when it covers a wide range of definitions. That's why, to try to grapple or to come to grips with the right definition, or the most adequate definition, you have to contextualize. Because verses descended as asbab al-nuzul according to socio-economic conditions. And when these conditions change, the laws have to follow and have to change. That's why I talked about heritage. I mean, I must say, we have never thought that this issue would be possible in a Muslim country like Morocco, to talk about equality in heritage. And now it's been done. Whether, and I hope, I hope we will manage, okay, to have a law about that. Because gender equality, equality is the road to peace. So, when you read the Quran, you say traditions. Now, you have to go back to the Quran, okay, with fresh eyes and a fresh mind, and get rid of false, try to get rid, it's not an easy task, it's arduous. Try to get rid of false, erroneous interpretations of the Quran, because hideous crimes, hideous violent acts have been committed and are still committed in the name of cultural specificities. Okay, so I think the to achieve perhaps the most adequate interpretation of Islam is to have linguists, historians, philosophers, gender studies experts, geographers. All these disciplines should come together, and this is the only way to prevent the fragmentation of knowledge into compartments. And this fragmentation leads to violence. When you have an imam or theologian say, well, what I'm saying is the truth. No, you are an unbeliever. You are a kafir. What would be your argument? Knowledge.
Thank you for such an intriguing conversation. And we are left with an open question about, do we want to be pure? Or do we want to have love, peace, equality? What are the priorities of these concepts in our lives? So we leave with an open question.
Thank you. Thank you.